Tour, welcome. Thank you very much for coming in. All right, fourth grade did this last year, presented. So they're excited to witness it instead of participate, I'm sure, right?
Yes.
I thank you all for coming very much. The third graders have been working really, really hard. I'm sure you've heard this same poem repeatedly at home, But think back 4 weeks ago when they first picked out their poems. And look where they are now. They're going to present them from memory. This third grade poetry fair started decades ago with, a very good friend of mine, Maria Furlick. I'm so sorry. She passed away a year ago. And she started this poetry fair as a colleague, a teacher at St. Jude, I think 30 years ago. Stopped 30 years ago? Long time ago. And she and I worked together as colleagues to keep it going. And here we are, still pursuing the poetry fair. So Katie is going to kick us off with prayer, and then we're moving right on in to some poems. Enjoy.
The number one reason we are at school is to learn. We all learn many things from our amazing teachers. Sam selected a poem highlighting one subject we learn about while we are at All Saints Academy.
Lessons, we learned about the state symbols of Michigan. Did you know that the mastodon is the
chicken fossil. Katie recites a poem about the state reptile.
The Turtle by Jack Polesky. The Turtlesaurus very kind to live within a shell, but why he cares to be confined, the turtle does not tell. The Turtlesaurus satisfied to slowly creep and crawl, and never wanders far outside his living room or home. So if you wish to visit him in his domestic dome, just knock politely on his shell, you'll find the turtle.
Michigan's history in third grade. But that's not all. We get to learn math and science and how to read better. Isley shares a poem outlining the wonders of reading a book.
The Lives Are Yours by Richard Moore. Books, I think, are extra nice. With books you live, not once but twice. You are yourself and you are things with fur or fins or shells or wings. As big as giants, as small as gnats, as far as stars, as close as cats. You live today and long ago, the future too is yours to know. You multiply and expand it free for you and also what you need.
Yesterday to somebody you know that you were due. The frogs got home last week, are settled and at work. Birds mostly back and the clover woman thick. You'll get my letter by the 17th, reply or better. Be with me. Yours, Y.
Even though bees and flies serve our world in great ways, they can be annoying tiny creatures. Am I right? But not nearly as annoying as snay. I can't even say it. We'll let Annie share her poem.
A snake named Rover by Maxine Jeffress. Mom wouldn't let me have a doll with all the mess they make. So if I couldn't have a dog, I said I'd like a snake. My mother gasped quite audibly when Dad approved the plan. A snake? He gulped. A real life snake. Well, sure, I guess you can. We went to Ralph's Repulsive Pets and bought a yarn asp. It coiled inside a paper bag held firmly in my grasp. I put him in a big glass tank and dubbed my new pet Rover. But all the fun of owning him was very quickly over, for all he did was flick his tongue once or twice each minute, while nervous Mom would check the tank to make sure he was in it. Then, one fine day, we don't know how, my Rover disappeared. My father told me not to fret, but Mom was mighty scared. We searched the house from front to back and gave the yard a sweep. By midnight, we had given up and tried to get some sleep. At 3 a.m., my dad arose to answer nature's call. I heard him scream, I heard him swear, and then I heard him fall. For Dad had found my weird pet had given up for dead, curled up inside a slipper, lying right beside his bed. Now Rover's living back at Ralph's with frogs, newts, and guppies. And now I have a dog named Spot. She'll soon be out.
Yikes! Be careful where you step. Without caution, you might meet up with a pesky pet. And sometimes we just don't want to imagine. Grant retells a tale of just such an encounter.
By Shel Silverstein. I'm being eaten by a boa constrictor, a boa constrictor, a boa constrictor. I'm being eaten by a boa constrictor and I don't like it one bit. Well, what do you know? It's nibbling on my toe. Oh, geez, up to my knee. Oh, my, it's up to my thigh. Oh, Phil, it's up to my middle. Oh, heck, it's up to my neck. Oh, dread.
Pretty intense. You need to be quite selective in your pet choices. Maggie recites a poem about another occasionally pesky little critter in and around the home.
Let's switch gears and think of some different pets. Caden shares a poem about a more gentle pet.
My elephant is different by Jack Pilotsky. My elephant is different than most elephants I meet. Its ears are short and fuzzy. It has feathers on its feet. It's scaly like a lizard and it's furry like a skunk. It sports a sort of auger where there ought to be a trunk. It doesn't much resemble other elephants I find. Tails like a mushroom on its tiny blue behind. It cackles like a chicken and it's 14 inches tall. At times I think my elephant's an elephant at all.
There are many pet conversations today. Tori has a poem to share with you about a rather large pet. Please don't be afraid.
There's a polar bear in our refrigerator. He likes it because it's cool in there. His feet in the meat and his face in the fish. His big hairy paws in the buttery dish. He's nibbling the noodles. He's munching the rice. He's slurping the soda. He's licking the ice. He lets out a roar. If you open the door, it gives me a spear. There's no reason there. That polar bear in our refrigerator.
I think that's all we have on pets for today. Some of those pets were big, some were small. Some of those pets were furry, some were not. Some of those pets made us smile, some did not. You may have experienced a couple of emotions with the last couple of poems. Was fear one of the emotions you felt? Emily recites a poem explaining a time when the emotion of fear was real.
Michelle Silverstein. Barnabas Browning was scared of drowning, though he would never, though he never would swim, or get into a boat, or take a bath, or cross a moat. He just sat day and night in the door, black tight, and the window nailed down, shaking with fear that a wave might appear, and cried so many tears that they filled up the room and he drowned.
Fear can bring on other emotions, like worry or sadness. Sophia would like to share a poem about being unhappy and one solution to change that feeling.
Unhappy Here by Shel Silverstein. Mail me somewhere, mail me somewhere. Wrap me, pack me, and mail me somewhere. Parcel post, UPS, regular mail or air, all wrapped up in brown paper that won't rip or tear, with stamps on my forehead and a string in my hair, and a tag on my butt that says handle with care. Based on any address, it don't matter where, Illinois or Kentucky or Delaware. Because wherever it is, I'll be happier there. So please ship me, send me, mail me something.
Solution. Another solution may be food. Who doesn't like to eat, especially good food? Josie has a poem about one of our favorite snack foods.
Pass the Pizza by Douglas Boring. I made a pizza that had no spice. I thought it might taste just as nice. I made a pizza that had no cheese. Instead, I threw in frozen peas. Fried potatoes. I made a pizza without any dough. Five people like pizza, I really don't know.
Well, pizza is a fantastic and tasty go-to snack or meal. Some food choices are not so wonderful. Wyatt will share a poem about some questionable options.
Shel Silverstein. Henry Hall moved here last fall. Henry Hall is strong and tall. Henry Hall outjumps us all. Give Henry Hall the basketball, he'd rip the basket off the wall. The others all would surely fall when Henry Hall would shoot the ball. We'd win them all with Henry Hall.
Hall hates basketball.
P.S. The one in the hat is Henry Hall. The one on the left is Quincy Hall. We hardly let him play at all.
Apparently, Henry Hall doesn't like to play basketball. Not everyone does. And some people can't get enough basketball.
When you fall in love with a sport, you want to succeed in all ways possible. And that means practice, lots of practice. The good news is that the practice pays off. We all won't be superstars in a sport, but Jake has a poem about basketball success.
Ace Iverson by Mel Blunt. The score is tied and it's filled with sweat. God let the ball fall through the net. I'm on the line, shooting a pair. The first one rolls off, black hole despair. Ball feels heavy, bouncing once more. Slow breath, let it drop for the score. The ball is up, the universe waits. The ball drops in 69-68.
We've all seen it. The clock is down to the final few seconds. The score is tied, and victory can be found in the final play of the game. Edward will illustrate a moment like this with the poem he selected.
Foul shot by Edward A. Boyd. With 2:60 stuck on the scoreboard and 2 seconds hanging on the clock, the solemn boy in the center of eyes, squeezed by silence, seeks out the line with his feet, soothes his hands along his uniform, gently drums the ball against the floor, then measures the waiting net, raises the ball in his right hand, balances it with his left, palms it with fingertips, breathes, crouches, waits, and then through a stretching of stillness, nudges it upward. The ball slides up and out, lands, leans, wobbles, wavers, hesitates, exasperates, plays it coy until every face begs with unsounding screams. And then, right before, roar up, dives down and through.
Everywhere around the world, the game of basketball is played, whether it's on a well-polished professional court or a small patch on the neighbor's driveway. We've all dribbled a basketball before. But I have a question. Is basketball played on other planets, like Mars maybe? Lance selected a poem which wonders that as well.
Where's the Ball by Robert L. Harrison. They found the hoops under the sands of Mars near a pile of basketball cards. The court stretched for at least a mile. When the Lakers heard, they clapped and smiled. The scorebook said there was a foul. 2 red men who left by the nearest canal. By the placing of the white and bones, it seemed the ref had died alone. No one knows which side won. Maybe those Martians are just having fun.
As you can tell, this group enjoys basketball, but we also enjoy baseball. Logan picked a poem about baseball, but you may not have thought about the game being played way back in during prehistoric times.
Perhaps by Avis Hulley. He saved the brown tail player's shout, but umpire tri-tip says, "You're out." No way, shrieks number 41, claims his tail tip scored a run. A fight breaks out between the teams. The air is wild with dino screams. Soon fans begin to lumber and creating prehistoric din. The scrimmage spreads into the stands. For days it rages through the land. When all the dust had settled down, silence covered every town. Perhaps this battle could be linked to why the dinosaurs extinct.
Thank you.
time, our beautiful creation has been a wonder to each generation. All the expansive waters, beautiful birds, amazing animals, and ever-changing weather. Anna found a poem that illustrates the gorgeous surroundings we can experience every day, if we keep our eyes open.
One took a nap in
would like to take pictures, go ahead and you can take a group picture, you can take individual pictures, but maybe 5 minutes, take a couple snapshots, and we will be gone. Thank you for enjoying your poetry fair and joining us.